Now I said, they said money is the root of all evil, but it actually says the love of money is the root of all evil. So it's not money itself. Money is just a tool. Money is gives you options in certain things. So let's kind of cover that real quick. Can anybody give me a definition of money? Anybody? Something you used to purchase something. That's not bad. Anybody else? Want to take a shot? Currency. Great. That's another nice word for it. All right, listen. Essentially, what money is it's a symbol. Like I said, a tool. All it represents is value that you want to give something. So if you really think about it, the money in your pocket, whether it's a dollar bill, $100, whatever the case is, it's a value we've assigned to it, right? If I were to bring it somewhere else that doesn't know, understand what that is, if I go into a rural area, let's say in some crazy part of the world, and I show them this Benjamin, they're going to look at me like I'm nuts. All they're going to do is wipe their behinds with it, to be honest with you. It's just paper, all right? What it symbolizes is, again, so let's say, for instance, you're a babysitter and you're working for somebody. You say, hey, I want to give you, I want $10 for your 60 minutes that I'm going to watch your kid for. So you're assigning a value to your time, whatever you're trading for that money. So if I want to buy the new iPhone, well, I'm trading $700, $800 for that iPhone. That's what it is. Does everyone understand that concept? All right? So what I want you to kind of restructure your mind and your mindset on what money is, see it as options. The more money you have, the more options you have. Less money you have, the less options you have. You know, I could walk into a dealership and want to buy a Lamborghini, but if my bank account says my options is a Hyundai, that's all it is. Everyone understand that concept? You sure? All right. This, by the way, I like crowd participation. Feel free to speak up. You know, feel like you're in church. You can yell back. I ain't a pastor, but you can yell back. I'm good with that. All right. I want you guys to be engaged and understand what it is that we're trying to accomplish here. All right. Now, there's different ways that you get money and how you earn money. Right. I know your parents always tell you money doesn't grow on trees. Has anyone heard that before? Yes. All right. Yes. Everybody heard that one before. The reason they say that is because when you start working and you're working a 9-to-5 or a business or whatever the case may be, you got to put some sweat equity into this. You got to put some toil. You got to get an education. Whatever it is you need to do to earn that money, that's why you got to understand they say it doesn't grow on trees. I hate that phrase because it makes you think that it's really much harder than it is. But when you start working, you'll start to understand the value of a dollar. Now, I guarantee you, I don't know if any of your parents had you buy your own stuff, let's say your own Jordans or whatever the case may be, and all of a sudden, when somebody steps on your toes, you're getting upset, you wiping everything down and all that kind of stuff because you spent your money to buy it. Now, when your parents gave it to you or your grandparents or whatever the case is, not saying you didn't value it, but you didn't think about it as much as when it was your money that came out your pocket for that, right? So with my kids, I tell them the same thing. I said, listen, I'm going to give you a gift, but if something happens to it, it's on you, right? So if you got that iPhone and that crack case, you know, the screen cracks, ain't me. I already did my job. I gave you what you were supposed to get, right? So you can start to understand the value of certain things. Now, there's different ways, like I said, that you're going to earn that money. You can get a 9-to-5. You can get a job, right? So remember what I was telling you about, like that babysitter example. I said, well, my hour's worth $10, so I'm going to charge you $10 an hour for that work that I give you. Or if you're a lawyer, some lawyers charge $400 an hour, right? It varies on what your level of education is, what level of expertise you have. The more value you add to somebody, the more you get paid, right? So I'm gonna give you guys a little insight. I haven't even put this up on here. So to the degree you can solve a problem, the more money you'll make. So if you're a doctor, and so let's say you're an internist, I'm seeing general practitioner, I'm seeing clients, I'm helping them with different things, they got a cold, this, that, and the other. I still get paid well. But if I'm a brain surgeon, very few people on this planet could do what I do, right? So now I'm going to get paid way more because I'm a specialist. I'm adding more value to people, all right? Everyone understand that concept? Yes? No? All right, cool. Now, there's self-employed. I want people to understand this. Self-employed means I own my job. I don't have a business. I own my job. Like, for instance, I'm a real estate broker, right? When I worked by myself, before I created a team, I am self-employed, meaning if I don't work, I don't get paid, All right? So I want people to understand the difference of that, because a lot of people think when they're self-employed, well, I run a business. No, you don't. Because if you don't work, you don't get paid. You go on vacation, you don't get paid. You're sleeping, you don't get paid. Everyone understand that concept? It's the same way when you're at a job. I clocked in, I'm getting paid. I clocked out, I'm no longer getting paid. All right? Now, the other aspect of this is owning a business. The difference of self-employed to owning a business is, hey, I got me who's working, but then I bought my assistant, I got another team person, so at any given time, other people are still making money for me, right? So if I got a manager who's running my business for me while I'm on vacation, I can check my bank account, I still see checks coming in. I still see deposits coming in, all right? A business is where, again, you could be sleeping, you could be on vacation, you could be playing with your kids on the playground, you could be at their recital, which I love to do, or watch they get paid. Which one likes that? Who likes that one? Oh, yeah, now everybody's hands go up, all right? Now, listen, not everybody's built to own a business, which is okay, right? You can still make a lot of money doing a job. You can still make a lot of money being self-employed, all right? I'm just giving you the different options so you guys can have an understanding of which direction you may want to move, you know, in your future, all right? Now, the ultimate place most people want to be who understand these concepts is an investor or using investments to make their money, all right? So let me put that down so that doesn't pop up here. Sorry about that, folks. All right. So it's being an investor or investments. So meaning the money that I already worked for, I send it out. I say, listen, money, do me a favor. I need you to go out there and bring me back more of your friends. Go have babies and come back. All right? So you guys got to understand this concept. Listen. This is the only time I'm going to ever say I like roaches. If you ever think about roaches, you see one, there's usually a couple million of them somewhere around. All right? So I want my one little dollar to become like those roaches and just keep on multiplying. We don't die, we multiply. Right? You ever heard that phrase? That's the place you want to be. This is the Warren Buffetts of the world. Right? This is a person who literally, if he doesn't work another day in his life, his money keeps going and going and going. He could die 20 times over. His kids, and so forth and so on will have money, right? You guys ever heard of the Kennedys, the Rockefellers, Andrew Carnegie, these people? That's what's called old money. Why? Because the investments that they made back in 1920, 1800s, whatever the case is still paying their family today, all right? That's when you hear the term generational wealth. So I have some money, I pass away, I want to leave it for my kids, but it's enough money where if my kids don't screw it up, they can leave money for their kids and so forth and so on, all right? That's the place where I think all people can be. You can get there with a job. You can get there self-employed. You can get there doing a business. So I'll give you an example that most people understand as far as an investment. I buy a piece of property, right? It has a couple tenants in it. It pays me a certain amount of rent. I have a certain amount of expenses. So I'll just, for easy math, we'll just use $100,000, right? So I'm making $100,000 a year in gross revenue from this investment, but I have some expenses. Let's say $25,000 for taxes, oil, gas, whatever the case is. So at a net number, how much am I making a year? $75,000. Now, as long as my tenants are paying me rent and that continues to do that, I'm making $75,000 a year on a one-time investment. And that's going to pay forever and ever and ever as long as I have my tenants paying on time, right? Same thing when you put money in the stock market and you get something called dividends, right? You invest in a company, you want that company to do well, like a Coca-Cola, AT&T, Apple, whatever the case is, they're supposed to pay you dividends. You put that money in one time, you're making more money on your money. Everyone understand this concept? Yes. Great, all right? Now, one thing I want you guys to really, really, really understand. Most people don't get this concept. Everybody wants to say, hey, I want to be comfortable. I want to be okay. That's cool. We can all do that. But at the end of the day, what you really want to do, you always want to be increasing your income, period. All right? Increasing your income. So whether, if I have a job, that's fine. Now I want to get a raise, right? I want a bonus. Cool. If I'm self-employed, hey, I want to either make more hours, make more moves that gets me more contracts, that brings me more money. I always want to be increasing my money. But the key thing here, people don't understand, I want multiple me's bringing money. So I want multiple streams of income. Does anyone understand that concept? Does anyone know what multiple streams of income is? Can anybody give me an example?
Maybe like making an investment in three different businesses while
Beautiful. He gets the concept. All right. That's right. See, I like to reward an action. All right. So that's why you got to speak up. So that's the reality. So you want to have multiple streams of income, right? So a lot of people say, hey, I want to be a millionaire. Everybody want to be a millionaire? Right? All right, cool. Now, they say for you to be a millionaire, you should have three streams of income at bare minimum. So that could be your job, an investment, like you said, another business, whatever the case is. But you want multiple streams of income. Does everyone understand this? Before it's all said and done, will we all have multiple streams of income? Yes, no?
Yes.
You sure? You don't sound convinced. Now, if I said I was going to pay you $100 for saying yes, would you say yes?
Yes.
You damn skip. All right, so let's cut it out. All right, but at the end of the day, understand something. The information I'm giving you, this is worth millions of dollars to you. I know you don't see it yet. If you understand the concepts I'm giving you, when it's all, I'm telling you. But let me see, you guys are all between, 16 to 18 years old, give or take? All right? So if you guys start using this information now, even through college, as we're going through this stuff, I promise you, in your 30s, if you work this right, 100%, I guarantee you, if you work this right, you will have either have made $1 million or have $1 million sitting in the bank or in an investment, 100%. Now, if you want that, keep listening. If you don't want that, do me a favor, walk out the room. All right, cool. I figure everybody is on the same page. I just got to make sure, right? All right, so you all hear, you got to save some money. You got to save your money. You got to save your money. You got to save your money. Everybody heard that? Parents say save some money? Yes, no?
Yes.
All right. What do you consider saving? Give me an example. Like putting in the bank. What do you consider? What? Give me some examples of saving money. You put your money in the bank, cool. I like this girl right here. All right, go ahead.
It's kind of what she said, I get paid.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So I put part of my paycheck in my savings account.
Beautiful. All right, cool. Now, why are we trying, why should we save money? For what in the future? That's my man right here. He said the magic answer. Say that, it's a little louder. To invest. People, please understand something. We don't save money to save money. All right? You just said you save money in the bank, right?
Yeah.
How much interest are you getting?
0.07.
Say that again?
0.07. All right,
0.07. So I'm going to skip to a little part in a second. Anybody know the rule of 72? Anybody? All right. So before I get, I'm going to come to her and I'm going to go to rule 72. Now, let me ask you guys a question. If I had, I think I do have it in my pocket for some odd reason, but if I have a penny and I said, listen, I'm going to give you, as a matter of fact, young lady who saves half, I like you, all right? Gave you a penny and I said, I'm going to give you 2 pennies tomorrow, 4 pennies the next day, 8 pennies the following day, or I said, I'm going to give you $1 million right now, which one would you take? I'm going to give you these, I'm going to keep doubling the pennies for 31 days. Which one would you want? Huh? Why?
Every penny counts.
Who would take the $1 million? As a show of hands, who would take the pennies doubling every day for 31 days, and who would take them? So who's going to take the pennies? Raise your hand. Okay, that's decent. How many of you would take the $1 million today? Anybody? Okay. What happened to the rest of you guys? You undecided? Let's try this again. How many would do you take the pennies doubling every day? Raise your hands. Okay. And how many would take $1 million today? Cool. All right. So if you took the pennies doubling every day in 31 days, you'd have $10 million in your account. Anybody still want the $1 million?
No.
Should I take that too? All right. So, well. Huh? Yeah. What this is, I mean, listen, if you can get 50% return every day, God bless you. All right? This is just an example. So what this is this the power of compounding interest. All right? The rule of 72 states whatever interest rate you're getting, and you divide that into 72, that's how many years it'll take for your money to double. So with your 0.017 or whatever the case is, how many years would it take for your money to double in that account? Your great-grandchildren would find that answer out. All right? So when we put money in the bank, please understand we're not leaving there for long. That's just a safe haven because it has FDIC insurance and all that fun stuff. All right, the reality is you put your money in the bank so that one day you can invest so that you can go send that money out to bring back babies. All right, to bring back, you know, as Mr. Wonderful would say on Shark Tank, they're my soldiers, they're bringing back, spoils of war, all right, they'll come back. So please understand this rule. This rule is critically important, all right? So whatever interest rate you're getting, so if I get a 10% interest rate on my investment, it'll take me 7 years to double my money, give or take, right? So why is it important, do you think, to start kind of investing or finding these kind of interest returns at a young age? Like, listen, just because you're in high school and college and going to college doesn't mean you can't find some of these investments. You could talk to your parents and say, hey, can we go in on something? Please, yes. Yeah, definitely. You got to be fiscally responsible, 100%. Now, is that a question or was there a... Huh? Question? Say it again. So I can make sure.
You were asking.
Yeah, I got you. Okay. So whatever you need to do, whether you start off by saving a little bit in stocks, you know, putting like, they have things like Acorn, you could put, you know, pieces into a share and things of that nature. Or, like I said, talk to your parents, hey, can we invest in some real estate on where I'm going to college? Whatever the case is. Now, obviously, you got to understand those dynamics and this. I don't have enough time to teach all that kind of stuff, but I want you to get the concept of knowing I want to get the best return on my money. So I don't want 0.01%, not for long at least, right? If I got to leave it there for a little bit, that's okay, but that's not my end goal, right? I want a minimum. Honestly, you should be looking for a minimum of 10% in most of your investments if you can. Now, when you get to a place where you got a whole lot of money, and whatever a whole lot of money is to you, to me, what a whole lot of money is that I have enough money that the interest on my money pays my bills every month. All right? All right. Now, let's talk about debt. Now, there's good debt and bad debt. Bad debt, anybody know what bad debt is? Any examples of bad debt? This is true. That is bad. That is definitely bad debt. So what credit cards are is something called revolving debt. All right. So revolving debt just means it'll continue to be going until either you stop using it and you shut down the account or you finish paying it off and so forth and so on. Now, unfortunately, bad debt can use the power of compounding interest against you. So you hear people who say they're going to pay their minimum payment and things of that nature. If you got like say a 20%, which actually no, let's take a student credit card. Student credit card is about 14%. So 14%, if you continue to pay the minimum payment, you're only paying the interest. It'll take you about, I believe, 7 years, and let's say you borrowed $10,000 just for, again, easy math. You would end up paying double that number. Yeah, you about so $28,000, give or take. So you bought a car on a credit card, for instance. I don't know why you do that, but I'm just giving you as an example. You would end up paying $28,000 for the same $10,000 car. Does anybody want to do that? Who wants that deal? Okay, all right. I would hope not. All right. Now, there's something called good debt. Does anybody know an example of good debt? The best one I can give you an example that most people can understand is a mortgage. All right. So this is a set and static debt. You know what you're going to pay at any given time for the length of the loan or whatever the case of that debt is. But I'm using that because I want you to understand it, because I like that real estate example again because I'm from the real estate world, is that you want to use what's called leverage. The only time debt is good is if you're using it to build yourself up. So if, for instance, I want to invest in a piece of property. I don't have $500,000 to buy it outright. I can't buy it cash, but I do have 50. So I have 10% to put down, and I'm going to borrow $450,000, all right? But I want to make sure that whatever rent I'm getting is going to pay the mortgage for that and then still give me a little bit of a profit. Now, that's when debt is good, because now I'm using debt to help me build my wealth. Does everyone understand the difference? All right? Credit cards will destroy you if you don't know how to use them. Please understand this. And they just changed the rules a little bit, but still on college campuses, when you guys go to college, you will get opportunities to get credit. They're going to give you a $300 card at first, and they say if you pay it off, you get $500 and so forth and so on. But now everybody, for some reason, when they have this little plastic card, they think it's free money. It is not free money. You are paying interest on it. And I think the least amount of interest I've seen is, like I said, 14% on a student card. All right? So if you get yourself in trouble with credit, now you're going to screw yourself up later on. You can't make that investment in the real estate thing. Like that example I just gave you. Why? Because your credit sucks. They're not going to lend you the money. All right? Just so you know, in America, what's more important than money is credit. You can do a lot more with credit than with money. Because I could take a small amount of money and make it a lot because I got good credit. Right? Like you hear, you know, people, comedians joke, you know, I got to find a girl with good credit. Or, you know, and things like that. Why? Because they understand that concept. I can go walk into, now, remember I told you that Lamborghini? Now, if I have enough money in the bank, I said that was a Hyundai, but if I know that I'm going to be making enough monthly money, I could take that little Hyundai money and borrow the money and get a Lamborghini. Now, that's a stupid investment because that's a depreciating asset. All right? By the way, that just reminds me, if anything rots, rusts, or deteriorates, you shouldn't buy it. It's not an investment. So them Jordans, not an investment. All right? People think, well, if I hold them long enough, maybe, maybe not. You want something that's going to have a value for the majority of people. All right? Now, if you flip in Jordans, that's a different story. If you can get them for a buck and sell them for three, now we got a self-employment business there. All right? Everybody understand what I'm trying to tell you? You're always trying to find ways to increase your money, not decrease it. All right? Anything you spend money on other than your gas bill, electric, you know, food and things of that nature should be to bring you back more money. All right? You always want to get what's called a return on your investment, ROI. All right? All right. So budgeting and credit management. So I got a few more minutes, so I'm going to move a little bit quickly. All right? You must keep track of your spending. You can use apps like Mint. I think there's something called Budget Guard and some different other ones. So every time you can connect it to your bank account. So every time you swipe that card, you can see at the end of the month what you're spending your money on. And if you start seeing you're wasting money, cut that stuff out. Not too much Starbucks, no Dunkin' Donuts, or you know whatever the case is. In college, most people spend a lot of money on Chinese food and pizza. All right, but keep track and understand how much you're spending every month. But as you see what I put on there up there, the young lady said, "Hey, I make a paycheck. I take half of it. I put it away." She said the same thing. Pay yourself first. You are your most important bill. The minimum you should save for yourself is 10%. Bare minimum. So if you get $100, put $10 away. That's for investments. All right? You're going to get to a point, and I'm just touching on this. You'll get to a point when you make enough money that you can have several different accounts. You can have a 10% account for investments, 10% for, you know, whatever it is, 1% for vacations. Start budgeting yourself so you understand where your money is going. So that way you're always using that money to go make you more money. All right? Always find a way to make yourself more money, save more money. Now, some of you have different faiths and different things of that nature. And some faith-based things, they say tithe 10%. Or if you want to give it to charity for 10%. Believe it or not, folks, everybody thinks they always look. When I was your age, I thought people were crazy. Take 10% of my money and give to what? Trust me, folks. I don't know why it works. I don't know in the universe, God, however you want to put it. You give 10% of your money away, somehow good things happen. I don't know how it works. I don't care how it works. It just works. All right? So it's a little bit of advice I'll give you. So when you're doing all right for yourself, be generous with other people. It comes back to you. As it goes around, comes around. That's that statement. All right? Also, remember I told you about credit? You can check your credit report on Credit Karma and annualcreditreport.com once a year. So as you guys get older and you start using these credit cards and doing different things and you're paying them on time, you can check your credit score, and as it builds up, you're doing phenomenal, all right? If you got an 800 credit score or more, you're beautiful. Yes?
Is it true that your credit score goes down when you check it?
No, not on these things. That's why they allow you to do it once. Like, there's something called soft checks and hard checks. So if you have, let's say you're trying to go get a car loan, and you got multiple people checking your credit, that hits your credit, right? Because they think you're trying to attain too much credit. It's a weird formula how they come up with this stuff. But what happens is it'll come down for a little bit, because especially if they're in a short period of time, let's say in a week, they'll realize you were trying to shop for a loan and you're looking for the best deal. And it'll bring you, once you complete it, you'll get your credit score back up because they'll realize that's what it's for. But if you just check the check, they're like, okay, something a little funny's going on here. And that's why it gives you a little bit of a thing. So before my time runs out, does anybody have any questions? Yes. Not true. So most loans have a grace period, and anywhere from 5 to 30 days. If it's a big loan, you have 30 days. Once it hits 30 days that you didn't pay it, that hits your credit. If you're 30 days late, 60 days late, 90 days late, you get 90 days late, you're in trouble. That's when credit scores go, whew, go plummeting like it's in the Grand Canyon. Any other questions? Yes.
How old were you when you first started to understand and really get the hang of managing your money?
My junior in college. Yeah. What the funny thing is, as far as the 10% part, my mother's been telling me that since I was a kid. Save 10% of your money. And that saved me many a times. Yes.
My mom says, when I'm making money, save 50% of it until you have enough money that you can, buy as much stuff as you want for, 6 months.
Correct. This is true. This is what's called a rainy day account. Real quick, I got about 2 minutes. Let me just go over this real fast and I'll answer your question. I want you guys to understand there's different levels to this game, right? Who wants to be poor? Everyone knows what poor is, right? You don't want to be there. Who understands what the middle class is? What's the middle class? No, young man here, but you got a couple.
It's the group of, it's usually the majority of a country between rich and poor. They've usually got wealth, so they're not doing poorly, but they're not in the 1%.
Okay, that's not bad. Who understands the difference between middle class and financial free, or being rich and financial free? Real quick. Correct. And the young lady, you was going to say something? Now, this might be a little controversial for you folks, especially that ourselves and our parents are in this world. The middle class sucks. And I'll tell you why. Because it's usually a revolving trap. You usually have just enough money to live comfortably, but you're always living paycheck to paycheck. All right? So, unfortunately, if there's an emergency that happens and you don't control your money, you're not investing your money, you're doing the right things, that's where you hear people having bankruptcies and foreclosures and things of that nature. All right? The difference with financial free and rich, and so you guys understand this, financial free is whatever your number is for you to live every month, you know, with all your bills paid, still do your little vacation, things of that nature, and you have something creating that kind of money for you, that's being financially free. Meaning you could do what you want, when you want, and how you want. That's the place I want to be, right? Now, wealthy, that's Bill Gates money, all right? That's being worth, you know, tens or twenties of millions. That's wealth. That is true wealth. That's where you can't go broke, pretty much. Does everyone understand that kind of that difference? All right? Any other questions before we shut down? Yes, I know, young lady, you had a question? Yes. So she asked if your credit score goes low because you didn't pay off stuff on the time, can you work it back up? Absolutely. It takes a little bit of time to do that, but within 6 months to a year, you can actually get your credit score pretty well up as long as you have a good payment history. Yes?
So I know that you said it goes down and multiple people check for it. So when you're looking for a car, they run your credit score, so how can you?
Well, again, because they know if you're doing in the same week or a 2 week period, give or take, credit agencies know that and see that, like their formula recalculates, and they bring it back up. It may take a point or two, but nothing really damaging. All right. Yes? That is, okay, that's another controversial one. Good credit. So the question was, what do you consider college debt, student loans? Remember I told you that ROI, you're spending money? So if you're going to spend money on your education, you're going to take loans out for your education, make sure you understand these concepts so when you come out of college, you're good to go. All right, so that way you pay that off and you got real money in your pocket. If you, listen, please do me a favor, don't go to school that costs you 60 grand if you're only going to make 60 grand a year. How are you going to ever pay that off? Now, if you go on to do something to make you, buck 50, 200, that's a different story. So my time is up, folks. I appreciate your time. All right.